Okay, so we're going to be fixing this Klipsch.
And what does that say? Pro Media 2.1. It's a computer surround system.
Obviously 2.1. One sub, two satellite speakers. But first, I'll give a quick tour of the lab. It's actually pretty big. Two workbenches. Racks of equipment. And a lot of my music stuff over here. Takes up about half of the basement. This is my bench for working on kind of older equipment. Got isolation transformer, kind of a smaller, older model, oscilloscope, audio signal tracer, capacitor tester that I've had forever, another capacitor tester, can't have too many of those, plenty of multimeters, can't have too many of those either. This is a much older model, 1980s HP. It's a 5.5 digit, I believe, multimeter. Got a soldering station, SMD hot air rework station, and a desoldering gun. Then over on this side, it's kind of a more modern bench. Got my oscilloscope, of course, microscope for SMD soldering, SMD soldering station. This is a electronic load that I built, so you can hook any DC power source up to that, and it will create whatever kind of load you want on that, DC load. Frequency counter, don't use that too often. This is a spectrum analyzer slash vector signal analyzer. It says it's 2.1 gigahertz, but I've actually hacked it. It goes to 3.2 gigahertz now. We've got a frequency reference, so red light means it's powered on. Once it locks, it will go green. It's a 10 megahertz reference. A signal generator says it's 40 megahertz, but I hacked this one. It's good to 120 megahertz now. Power supply. This is what I call Fuse Saver. It's a project that I made. And so you can select a database of different fuses. And then when you power it on and attach whatever device you want to power there, this will act as the fuse for you and prevent you from blowing fuse after fuse while you're troubleshooting. So it's just an electronic fuse. It'll go green when it's on, and then if it trips, it turns red and it'll give you a warning on the screen, and of course it'll shut off power to whatever device you have connected. Lastly, I've got my laptop for the lab. Probably looks familiar. A really nice touchscreen multimeter, bench multimeter, and 3 output power supply. This one's still booting. When your multimeter has to boot up. Yeah, I gotta fix that. It needs a battery. Yep, 6.5 digits. Really fast update. So that's pretty much it for the lab. We're gonna move on to this, doing a repair. So I thought an interesting way to start out with this, since it really is a linear function, you have audio coming in, which I've set up here. You can see we have the audio jack coming in. I've got the same signal coming in to both left and right. And then I'm measuring either one there. And then I'll come over to the oscilloscope. It's going to be difficult to see because of the glare. But I'll do my best here. real professional here. Okay. So let's set up. So we're going to use a Bode plot, or Bode plot. Some people say it differently. And what this is going to do is it's going to run a sweep of frequencies. We're going to go 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz. That's the generally accepted range of human hearing. Most people, by my age anyway, don't really hear that well that entire range. 20 hertz, you feel it more than hear it. And by the time you get to 20 kilohertz, you normally can't hear it anymore. Usually about 16 kilohertz is where it would cut off. But that's about where you would design an audio amplifier like this. 20 to 20 kilohertz. So we're going to do, let's say, 10 points per decade. And so we'll just run it. Well, hold on. Trace visibility. We don't want any phase information in this instance. We're just curious to see what the actual amplitude is across the entire range. So let me turn on the amp. And we'll set up and run the sweep here. And so you'll see some traces come across the screen. Get that out of the way. As it sweeps through. This will take a little while here. And again, these are just the left and right channels. So in this instance, blue is the left channel and pink is the right channel. So this will give us a baseline of what we're going to be working with. Okay, so it hovers right around minus 1 dB, and then around 2 kilohertz it starts dropping down to around maybe minus 15 dB. Alright, that gives us a starting point. And it's not going to be exact, it's going to run the sweep again, it'll be slightly different this time. So I could save this, but I'm just going to take a picture. Out of laziness. And let's go ahead and actually open up the amp and see if we can see anything visually. Okay, so I've turned power off and unplugged it. Now we'll just get all these screws out. I think it makes the most sense to start in the actual head unit itself rather than the preamp. There is a preamp built into one of the speakers, but I don't think that's the problem. I think it's very unlikely that's the problem. Most of your heat's going to be in here, and that's where your components are going to get the most stress from, is from the actual heat. It's possible, of course, that it's in the preamp. We may end up having to go there later. We're going to be opening that up one way or another to get in there and clean potentiometers correctly. But yeah, I think most likely our problem's going to be in here. This is where the majority of our amplification is happening. So our preamp comes in here, and that's our output there. Alright, let's see if that's enough. Let's pull this back off. Oh wow. There we go. It's just stuck. Alright, look at that. And what we have in there is just a fairly massive driver and a tuned port. It's where all your weight is in there. Okay, but the part we're interested in is here. So let me rearrange everything and we'll take a closer look at this. So there was just a couple lugs here going to the subwoofer that was easy to remove. And interestingly, there seems to be a manufacturing date here. Looks like August 1st, 2004. And in the enclosure, there was another one. What does that say? August 10th. So, yeah, it's about the same time frame. So, August of 2004. So, that makes sense. So, we have a large transformer here. Obviously, it has a linear power supply. You wouldn't want a switching power supply in something like this. That just had way too much switching noise. And you want this to actually be quiet. Let's see what we've got. There's some electronic shielding around the transformer, which is nice. That's a nice touch. One thing I didn't notice was any batting inside of there. That would be nice to kind of dampen any resonances in the enclosure. But yeah, unfortunately there was nothing like that. So this is your linear power supply section up here. You can tell because you have bridge rectifiers that'll take the AC from the transformer and that will rectify it into DC. These large capacitors here, these are obviously filtering out all of that raw DC that we have. And so there's two of those. I'm not sure. There's a couple different rails, I guess. No, that's kind of hard to see. Maybe better from that angle. It's pretty dark, though. Looks like we have a relay down in here, this blue thing. That's an inductor here. A couple more capacitors down there. This looks like... really hard to get in there and see that. Let me get a flashlight. Make it a little bit easier. Yeah, so, I don't know if you can see, it's really hard to tell. These capacitors were gunked down at some point. Yep, and so we've got a lot of little components down in here. Yeah, I think I'm just going to have to go handheld for this. Okay, forget the tripod. So, get the flashlight. It's interesting, there's a capacitor down there that's getting kind of smashed to the side by another capacitor. Like, it was never pushed down into the PCB properly. It is raised up from it. And it's kind of pushed against that other capacitor. It shouldn't cause any problems, but that is a little strange. There's the other components I was talking about. A couple transistors, a few transistors, some resistors. Everything looks to be okay there. I don't think that's a major issue. We can check out these main filter capacitors and make sure that the effective series resistance and the leakage current on them are good. We have another board over here. Not sure what this one is doing. Pretty difficult to see in there. That one would appear to be from the preamp. Because that connector right there, that yellow blob, that is actually the preamp input. And they did actually blob that over with that glue, the silicone, intentionally. That's to prevent any air leaks in this enclosure. You wouldn't want air leaks because with the speaker, any air coming in is either going to whistle or it's just going to throw the tuning of your cabinet off completely. It's supposed to be tuned to get a specific frequency range, and if you have air leaks, it's going to throw that off. So that's a nice touch. They have zip-tied, a large coil, looks like a coil there, just to keep that from rattling. That's a nice touch. There's lots of little kinds of bracing, I guess you would call it, metal bracing, just to keep things from moving around too much, setting up any major vibrations. It does rattle a little bit, but it's not too bad. So that's the backside of your output jacks there. And that comes down and around to this board over there. Got a couple fuses. Let me tip this over, make it easier to see. So there. Got a fuse there. Another fuse back there. A couple transistors, it looks like. Some big power transistors. More electrolytics. Some smaller signal transistors, diodes. Same thing here, another riser board. They look to be twins, so this is probably left and right channels, since these two are identical. Don't know which one's which, but one's going to be left and one's going to be right. I don't see anything going on with either one of these physically. You notice that smaller package mounted to the heatsink in the back and the middle. That's probably a thermistor to measure the temperature of the heatsink, which the heatsink is just the back panel, but that's going to measure the temperature of that back panel and make sure that none of these transistors are overheating. Okay, now I want to come lastly to something I saw at the beginning. I don't know if it was evident in the video or not, but let me put a light on it. Look at that. Obvious heat damage to this board. Lots of blackened gunk all over the place. Something went very wrong. There's some all over that IC, down on the back board underneath it. So I'm not sure exactly what happened. Maybe one of these transistors went bad, brought something down with it. But I think we're going to have to get this board out of there and figure out what exactly happened. It looks like it happened down low. I don't think that any of this charring that you see up here on these transistors, I don't think any of that is the actual problem. I think the problem is more likely at the bottom. The smoke kind of rose up. So let's see, what will it take to get this board out? We've got some screws there, nothing major. I think we're gonna have some solder joints at the bottom. Yep, it looks like maybe we have some solder joints at the bottom that we'll have to remove. See those longer pins coming down? I think that will have to be desoldered. So let me see what it takes to get this board out. We'll take a closer look at it. I think that's probably a problem. Where there's smoke, there's fire. So unfortunately, because of the way this is designed, I had to take both the board I actually want to get out and the board that was under it off of that heatsink panel. So there's a little bit of glue there. What we'll do is, looks like what we need to remove are these joints here and these joints here. So I've heated up my solder sucker. So let's pull these. Thank you. Is that enough to do it? Looks like it. Clean that off. Okay. There we go. Came right apart. Let's get this to the other bench and get a close-up and see if we can figure out what went wrong. Well, this isn't smell-o-vision, but I can tell you that it's pretty obvious that something went wrong here. I can smell that. That is strong. So you can see this is the bottom side here. Having trouble really determining what actually caused this. Because the burning appears to go all the way down. Let's take a look at the other board. So there's the burn mark on the other board. Something looks rather weird there. I think it got hot, but at the same time, is that what caused our issue? This coil here? It almost looks like it, since you have burn marks on either side of that board. That would have been that board sitting there. But you know, I don't really see a lot on the back side there. It appears to mostly be in the front here. So it's not really obvious what happened there. Let's see. No. So that is some kind of inductor. Because I can see the coils in there, the copper winding. I highly doubt that would go bad. For one, it's really large. Maybe it got hot, but I don't think it would have went bad. Number two, they don't normally just go bad. We do have a schematic. And what are they calling that? It says P101 and P102. Oh, that must be those plugs. Where's the actual ref des for that? M101? No, that's mount. I'm not sure. I don't actually see a silkscreen for that. But we can check some things out on this board and see if anything else actually failed here that would have caused this blackening. Okay, so looking at this closer, I think I know exactly what happened. That smoke and damage to the board up here is probably from this capacitor. It's got kind of a dusty appearance to the outside, so I can kind of wipe that away. Nothing on my finger, but the reason I think that is because there's kind of a manufacturing defect here. This capacitor is sitting up off the board, and it's tilted and actually touching this power resistor. Ideally, you would keep electrolytic capacitors like this away from hot components of this type. Now, I know it sits up like this where it's installed, so the heat from these would tend to rise that way, and this is actually below. And, you know, it's difficult to deal with ideal scenarios in this situation because you really don't have a choice. You have to have that capacitor in the circuit somewhere. So they've done the best they could. They've got all of the electrolytics down here toward the bottom. And up here, you can see where the heat path would be. You don't have any electrolytic capacitors over here. That's not really in the path. So they've done the best that they could, but this one manufacturing defect actually caused some problem, I think. Because if you look, yep, look at that. That mark on the capacitor, it got hot. And there's an electrolyte in here, and it's kind of a gel. And once it starts to dry out, then the series resistance of the capacitor goes up. And once that happens, it gets hotter, and it dries it out more, and it gets hotter, and it runs into thermal runaway. Eventually, it will pop. Normally the vent on top, that's what this little X on top is for, is that if the pressure were to build too much, it would pop. Is that my imagination or is that bulged out a little bit? It could just be the shadow there. But we'll put the tester on this capacitor, probably a couple other ones nearby since they probably got hot too. See how they're doing. Ooh, that doesn't feel... It feels like the solder joint's cracked on that. Oh yeah, look. Look at that. It actually has broken the trace. Because the board has gotten so hot. This side seems to be okay for some reason, but it has a thicker plane attached to it. That is much thinner. That's kind of a layout problem there. They didn't do a good job with that. So that's going to need to be jumpered there. And I'll have to heat this joint up, make sure that's okay. Should also check these resistors. Make sure that they're still within tolerance. Let's get this in shot. So we've got two here. This value is not making sense to me. I looked at the schematic and I think these are supposed to be 1K. Hold on, it's hard to get a good connection. How's that? There we go. Yep, just under 1K. That's good. Check this one. Well, a little lower, but it's within 1.5%. So that's pretty good. I don't think that's any kind of problem. I think probably that capacitor is our biggest problem. So I removed that capacitor from the board. You can see it's got a lot of like dust crap on it. It's a 100 microfarad 50 volt that matches the schematic. It's an 85 degree C rated part. I would think for an amplifier like this, they should be using the 105 degree C version. If it's going to be subjected to high heat, you can see how much that has actually been subjected to heat, that the plastic coating is just chipping away. That's very unusual. I've never seen that. And there's like a burn spot on it. So I'm going to put this on the capacitor tester and see how it measures. Okay, we'll start by setting it to 50 volts. Let's do a value on it. 360 picofarads. Wow, that is way low. Way low. Like, over 1,000 times less than what it should be. Let's do series resistance. Wow, it's measuring open. Let's do a leakage on it. No leakage. A capacitor like this should not just instantly drop to 0 microamps. It should take a while to charge up. So this capacitor is open. It's completely dead. That's unusual. Typically these fail short. So the fact that it failed open might have actually saved the rest of the circuit. So I guess we'll put a new one in, fix the circuit board, and see what that does. But I'm not incredibly hopeful because this board that we're actually working on, this is actually the subwoofer board. This is not one of the satellite amplifiers, so I don't think this is actually even related to the initial problem that we're having, so there's probably more problems to be found. Okay, so what I've done now is I've actually taken another capacitor off of the board. Let's see. It was here. You can see where the other one was. I took this one off that was adjacent to it. Same value, same voltage, everything. And I just want to see how that one tests in relation. So let's start with value. Again, 390 picofarads. Let's do a series resistance. Looking like it's open. Straight to zero. Yeah. This one is also open. Let me just verify. Yep, that is not the same capacitor. So wow, we already have two open capacitors. So yeah, this definitely has issues with capacitors going open, although that was still next to that resistor, so it's possible that got pretty hot. So what I'm going to have to do is start keeping track of these, pull these out, start testing the capacitors individually, because I don't have any level of confidence right now that there are going to be ones that are not open. There's quite a few capacitors on this. Take me a while to go through that. I won't show every single one, but we'll get the subwoofer board done. And I think what I'm going to have to do, given the number of failures that I've already seen, which is more than I would have expected, is to go through each board individually. I won't replace anything yet, just in case we find out that it's not economical to repair, but go through and systematically check each board and see what I find wrong, make notes, and kind of figure out what it might cost to actually do the repairs. So with the problems that we've been having, I decided to take the MOSFETs out of this board, test them, just to make sure that they're behaving as transistors. This is a cheap tester, but it'll do the trick. Okay, so in-channel enhancement MOSFET, gate threshold voltage 3.5 volts, the gate capacitance 2.21 nanofarads, RDS on 0.2 ohms, that's the source to drain resistance while it's on, showing the body diode between 2 and 3, forward voltage of 6.15 millivolts of the body diode, that is. Yep, that one looks good. Let's test the other one. Yep, that one looks good too. P-channel this time makes sense because it's push-pull. They're going to be complementary. Yep, everything makes sense. Slightly different characteristics, but nothing to worry about. Okay, moving on. So I just saw something kind of concerning. So here's the two MOSFETs that we tested, Q6 and Q7. Here's those two bad capacitors, C14 and C16. Those are the two big resistors, R17 and R16. That all seems to be a power supply circuit going here off to the TL074. That's a quad op amp. And you can see that here in the input circuitry. But that's the power rails. So I wouldn't expect that the power rails should be drawing so much power through those 1000 watt resistors that it would overheat these capacitors here and here. I need to check these 200 microfarad caps too. And I'll check these clamping diodes as well just to make sure they're okay. I did check this resistor, that's okay. So I feel pretty good about the output section. But that is a little bit odd. I might desolder that TL074 and see what kind of resistance it has across the power leads. See if it's trying to draw excess power. That could very well be the issue here. So interestingly, despite these two capacitors being what I would consider complementary parts, they're two different brands. Suscon? What is that, like suspect capacitor? Because it's looking sus. And G-Luxon. Same value and temperature rating, 16 volts, 100 microfarad, 85 C. And same thing on this one. I'm not really sure why they would be different. Obviously, they ran out of parts and had to get something quickly. I don't know. Also, I tested that TL074 op amp, and its power rails were like 4 meg. So, plenty of headroom there. I don't think that's causing any issues. So, we'll keep looking. I think some of these caps might still be bad, though. Okay, so as it turns out, the hard part is trying to find a capacitor that's not bad. This one's good. I checked it because it was kind of a darker color. It's supposed to be a bright green. It's kind of blackened, but I think that's just from being near the smoke that it escaped. This one reads good, but those last two electrolytics, the ones that were mismatched, they both read bad too. So that's four so far, all in that area. So far the issue is bad capacitors. And a couple crack solder joints, but that's also from the heat. So, keep looking. So I've removed every single capacitor from this board, and every single one was bad. They were pretty much all open. That was the typical failure mode. So now I'm going to go through and read some of these resistor values, just make sure these are okay. So that should be 100K. Yep. 1K.
Yep. 2.2K, or 22K rather. Yep. 1K. 6.8K. 10K.
So far so good. I'll go through and read the rest of these and see what we end up with. Okay, I've read the rest of them. Everything looks good. I checked all the diodes on the board. It looks good. IC is good. None of these ceramic caps are likely to be a problem. Those almost never fail. FETs are good. These larger resistors are good, with the exception of the broken solder joint on the bottom. Probably not going to be able to show that, but we do have a broken solder joint here that needs to be repaired. I'll just run a wire from here over to the other pad just to make sure that the signal gets through, but we're going to have to replace all of those capacitors at a minimum for this board. So this was in really bad shape. I highly doubt this worked at all. Look at that burn. All that board is all burned. It should be like a nice brighter color brown, kind of like there you go, in the corner you can see that compared to this. The whole board is just black instead of that lighter brown of the phenolic. So yeah, I don't think the subwoofer worked. I didn't test that. I wasn't looking for that. There's probably enough bass in the two satellite speakers that you'd hardly notice unless you really cranked it. So that's obviously an issue, but that's not the issue that I got the complaint for. So we'll have to keep checking. I think we're done with this one for now. We're going to move on. I'm not sure which one we want to do. We have the power supply board. I could do some quick checks on that, and then we'll probably want to remove... Given the way things are going, we might just want to remove every single capacitor, but these four big ones at a minimum, since that's going to induce some hum in the audio if it's not good. So, yeah, I guess we'll go from there. Okay, so we've got one of these big, very massive caps here. Sorry, I went handheld here. It's just easier. 4,700 microfarad, 63 volts. Come over here. There's no 63 volt setting, so I put it on 50. Let's make sure we're on large aluminum electrolytics. We'll do a value. A little bit of an overachiever. Should be 4,700. It's 52. That's not unusual. These are usually rated like plus 80%, minus 20%. So it's probably within tolerance. Let's see this. That's not surprising, given its large value. Yep, that's behaving the way I would expect. It's charging up. It's drawing less and less current as it charges. It's dropping down pretty quickly. And it's probably going to be a couple hundred microamps when it stops. It's not going to be perfect. I'm just going to call it there. It beeped there because there was enough energy in this capacitor when it was discharging it that it could blow a fuse. Hopefully it did not. There's a little fuse inside there. And let's check its series resistance. Minus one, that means that there's still a little bit of voltage on there. So, not too worried about it. Seems like that ESR is pretty good and it's behaving the way I expect. Let's test the other ones and we'll go from there. I discharged the capacitor completely. Let's test the ESR again. 0.1. 0.1 ohms. Oh, it's even dropping a little here. Yeah, 0.07. Can't complain about that at all. Yep, these caps are good. That's a relief. So looking at the power supply board here, there's that 500 microhenry rod core inductor. That filters the output of the Class D amplifier, because a Class D amplifier is essentially a square wave when it comes out. This filters all the higher order harmonics
it gets just the original low frequency sine wave back out of it. That's how you get the efficiency. So you need a big filter like this. I'm going to cross that with my ESR tester. And let's see what we get. 483 microhenry. Can't complain about that. Sounds pretty good. I just worried about that one a little bit because of the amount of char marks around it and the fact that that was connected to that subwoofer board that was completely fried out. So, no, doesn't seem like there's any issues here. I'm not going to check this other inductor because it's probably good and it isn't. It's pretty robust. I don't think that's going to be a problem. So, we'll just make sure that we get audio out. If this is indeed bad, we won't get any audio out of the subwoofer. So, we'll continue on. I think I'll check these four large caps. Let's see here. Those are all good. I'll put those back in. Checked all of the resistors on here and the small diodes and the bridge rectifiers as well. And signal diodes, little guys there. Those are all good. Transistors all seem to be good. I just did a quick test with my multimeter from base to emitter. Make sure that I get the diode junction drop there. Everything looks good there, so we'll just have to start testing some of these smaller capacitors and see if any of these are dried out and bad like they were on the subwoofer board. Just thought I'd show some of the larger caps being soldered back in. Should be using my fume extractor for this, but I'm keeping my head away. I don't know if that counts. Yes, I do have a fume extractor. I usually would use it. Okay, last one here. It's good to get some fresh solder on these anyway. These flow soldered things, the wave soldered back in the day, were not great. Notorious for cracking. So that fresh solder will be nice on there. So, set with that, I'm going to desolder some of these other ones, and we'll give them a test. I'm continually surprised by all the different brands of capacitors they actually used. This one's a Solaso or something? I don't know. NP means it's not polarized, which is unusual. Most electrolytics are polarized. Plus or minus 20%. 85 degrees C in a power supply, that's not very good design practice. 220 microfarads at 50 volts. I checked it, and everything seems good. This one is also good. Surprising, though, it is light. That is very light. Normally, capacitors are heavier, so that's very odd. But, yeah, I'm just continually surprised by all the different brands. Why mix and match? Just buy one brand. That's what most people do. Oh, well. One thing that's not good, and normally would give me reason to believe that this board has been reworked, but I don't believe it has. And another thing that's strange is there's actually a polarity marker on here, and it has a smaller footprint, but it has this large non-polarized cap in it, which, the thing that I'm saying is bad practice is, look how big it is. It's so big that they actually had to push this other one out of the way to make it fit. It's like they couldn't get the right part, and so they just put that in there. It's got the gunk on it, which matches all the other gunk, so I think it's factory. But again, it's like they ran out of parts, so they just used whatever they could find. Because this smaller footprint and that silkscreen plus sign tells me that this is not the cap that normally would be in there. It's the right value. But again, different brand, non-polarized, too big. What's going on? Come on, Klipsch. Is that how you say it? I don't know. Anyway, sad. Just want to give an update. As you can see, we've had a slew of bad capacitors. These are from the power supply board that I'm working on here. And those are from the subwoofer board. These are the bad ones so far. So I'm testing a couple more here. I've got one on my leads there. And just want to show you what a good one actually looks like, since we've seen so many bad ones now. Let's do a value. This should be 47 microfarads. Pretty much perfect. Let's do an effective series resistance, 4.2 ohms. I looked it up on the chart. 9.88 is the maximum that it can be, so we're well within the limit. Let's do a leakage. And no leakage. You can see it took a little while there to charge up. It blinks while it's charging. Well, now it's charging up quickly because I've already done it, but test value again. You want to test value after you test leakage at high voltage because that will test the dielectric absorption and whether or not it changes value, and it doesn't. So we've got a couple good caps here. I've tested this other smaller one here. That one's good too. So I'll solder these back in, but unfortunately these capacitors are all bad. So I'll keep going through the boards and see if there's any other bad parts. Okay, so now this board, this interface board here with the two left and right channels for the satellite speakers has to come out. I pulled all of the screws, but unfortunately this nice seal that we have here is going to have to come out. It's all gunked up to get a good sound seal, but that is clearly going to be a problem. So maybe I can pry this out of here. Not sure. Oh, this stuff's hard as a rock anyway. Look at that. It's just chipping off. This is supposed to be like silicone. Maybe I'll silicone this or even hot glue it when I'm done. Just to, aha! There we go. So I'll have to scrape this stuff off. It's hard as a rock. It's not supposed to be. This is supposed to be soft and pliable, and clearly it's just crumbling. Just from age and heat, sort of thing happens. So yep. And then we'll get some new thermal paste on these thermal pads. Get it all cleaned up. So we'll desolder this, take it apart, make sure we don't get these swapped just in case. And we'll go from there. I gotta save these mica spacers here. These are mica. It's like a stone, like a rare earth mineral. Very fragile. So I'll set these aside so they don't get broken. I don't know if you could have seen that or not. This mica insulator, just to keep the body of the FET, or I don't know if it's a FET or if it's a BJT, from touching the metal. And if it did that, if it all touched the metal, these are usually connected to the drain or the collector of the transistors, and it would short all of those out if they weren't insulated. And the thermal paste, a little bit sticky, but mostly it's dried out, so that could definitely use with a refresher. So I'll get these boards out, make sure I track which one's which, and then get these boards out, track which one's which, and check these caps for the most part, because we've had a lot of caps go bad already, and see if we can't figure out what the complaint about the left and right speaker is. I think it was the right speaker that went out, if I remember right. I'm thinking that the issue that we're seeing there is basically just bad caps. You know, one of these caps has dried out, either on this board or that one. I don't know which is which. And that's probably why you're seeing the issues. Just desoldering these riser boards here. So really hard to do from behind a camera. Normally I've got my head down in the work. But we'll make it work. I
It took me a long time before I actually bought this desolder pump tool. Because I don't really do that much through-hole stuff anymore. I do a lot of surface mount. So that's what my hot air rework station is for. But you know, when it does come to through-hole, which you occasionally do, nothing beats having the pump. It just makes such quick work of that. Now, should just... I did mark these so that I'd know which is which, by the way. And there we go. That's that. So I'll need to go through this board. I'm not sure what this one's called. I'll check the fuses, of course. They look okay, but you can never be certain just from looking at it. Check these diodes, resistors. Probably won't check these film caps. They look nice and green. They don't look too bad. Usually film caps don't go bad. Ceramic caps also don't go bad. This IC doesn't have a blowhole in it or anything, or a black spot in the middle. It's probably okay. But I'll check the ohms on the power rail and make sure that it's not trying to draw excess current for some reason. Check all the resistors, make sure they're a good value. Caps, of course. Caps will be the big ones. But it looks like we only have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 electrolytics on this board. And then 4 electrolytics on each one of these. So there's a lot of caps in total. But really, not too bad. They're not really big caps either. These are obviously done for filtering and DC blocking for the signal. Nothing power related for any of these. All the power related ones. Usually the power related ones are the ones that go bad, not the signal ones. But in this instance, it seems like all the power ones are good and the signal ones went bad. But that's because they use cheap capacitors. You know, I've never heard of Suscon. It's not even Suscon. It's... well, probably won't be able to end up seeing that. S-U-apostrophe-S-C-O-N. Don't know what that's supposed to be all about. Some are Suscon. And then there's like a Luxon cap. I don't know why they mix and match. There seems to be no rhyme or reason to which ones actually end up are good or bad. It's just a little bit of mix and match. They're just cheap caps, and so they fail, especially with heat. I think that's what it was. It got real hot for some reason, and they failed. So keep going through and checking caps. That's the big thing. And then we'll check these 4 output transistors on the transistor checker here. Make sure that what we're seeing makes sense. So I will continue. Just gonna check these fuses really quick. This one here, looks like one per board, probably for the power rail. 0.8, that's good. 0.2, should be a little corrosion on there. There you go, that's a little bit better. There, 0.2, that's probably the same as the leads. Yeah, see, I could rel that out, relative mode. Short the leads together and you'll get something closer. Now there is some resistance in the fuse anyway. That's how it burns out. As you run too much current through it, that little tiny bit of resistance is enough to start dissipating some power, and eventually it will blow the fuse. It'll get too hot and melt through. So fuses are good. That was an easy one. Now I'll go and check the resistors and things. Still going through this kind of like interface board that interfaces with the left and right channels there. Just checking capacitors. Where is glare? Maybe better there. So I figured I'll try this LCR meter instead of the Syncor one that I've been using, because unlike normal, the majority of the problems don't even seem to be with leakage. Oh, that's not working. I'm not getting a good connection. It doesn't even seem to be that leakage is the problem. It seems to be open. None of them seem to be shorted. So, just putting on this attachment with the clip leads.
see, negative to negative, and positive to positive. And what is this thing supposed to be? 10 microfarads, that's not bad, it's a little low. Let me do that and we'll look at the ESR. ohms. That seems a little high, but let me look at the chart. Depends on the voltage. So that's a 10 microfarad 50 volt. So that's allowed to have... just looking it up here. 33 ohms, so that's actually good. So that's a good capacitor there. We haven't seen too many of those. It's a little low on the value, but it can be as much as 20% low, and that's less than 20%. So I think we're okay there. Wow, actually a good one. We've had a lot of bad ones. There's so far 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14 bad ones already, and we're only about halfway through. Just going to go around and check some of these diodes on the interface board. I checked the caps. All the caps are good. So this board is in good shape. So far, it's the only board that didn't have any bad caps at all. Not sure how this one got through unscathed. But I'm just going to check some diodes and resistors here. 0.6, 0.7 volts is what you would expect across that PN junction on the silicon diode. So 0.7, yeah, this is all what you would expect to see. Cool, those are all good. Another one hiding back here, it looks like. 0.7. So those are all good. Normally I wouldn't shotgun a design like this where I just go and check every single part. That's very unusual. I'm more likely just trying to get to the root of the problem. But this had so many bad capacitors and so many char marks and broken traces, crack joints and problems in general. Just quality problems that you wouldn't expect to normally see, that I just felt like I couldn't leave it alone as is. I had to go through and check everything just to be sure that it's going to be okay. So I'm definitely doing a little more than usual. There should be a 10K resistor. Close enough. 10K. Close enough. Can't tell what that is. 47K? I can't read those bands, they're too tiny. Yep, 47K, yep. These tiny little 8th watt resistors. Surface mount ones would be even harder to read. They've got these little numbers on them. 10K, yep, that's right. And it's basically a mirror image split down the middle between the two, which again makes sense. You got the two signals coming off. So we got this guy. I'm not going to worry about these green film capacitors. I think I mentioned that before. It's just, it's very unlikely that those would fail. They do occasionally, and we'll track it down if we have an issue later, but that's very unusual that would fail. That's supposed to be 68K, close enough. Yep. Another 10K. Yep. So far, so good. I haven't seen any resistors that are out of tolerance. That was supposed to be 15K, by the way. I don't know what these are supposed to be. That one's got some capacitance on it. Oh, no. Maybe just some corrosion. Let me flip the leads around. Sometimes that makes it obvious. 22K. I can't read the band, so, but it seems reasonable. I can compare that to the schematic later. Not getting a good... there we go, 22K. Is this gunk that's on there? Has it become conductive? It has. That's what I'm reading. Wow, so this is not even the part, this is the board. 1 meg. The board is reading less than 1 meg ohm. That's not good. That's not good. I gotta make sure I scratch all of that away. That's another fail. We've got conformal coating that's now conductive, which, and it's covering the tops of these components, so it's actually going to start messing with the values here. Wow, that is just amazing. So many problems with this. I got to check and see which other boards have this conformal coating on them. I don't think it's too bad, but I'll have to scrape all that away, clean it up, make sure that it's not conductive in places you wouldn't expect. But otherwise, this board looks good. These are all good parts. I haven't checked. I guess I can check this op amp here. Another TL074. Yep, it's open. Check the other way. This is across the power terminals just to make sure it's not completely shorted out. 40k, that's low enough. Any voltage that would go there, that's not going to destroy it. So, okay, this board's checked. Everything looks good. And we'll move on to, now, we've got these two boards. And then we'll get to the board that's actually inside the one of the speakers, the little preamp board. So, I'll go through these now and we'll see what we get. Okay, so I've gone through the two left and right channel, or that way. I don't know which way it actually goes. It doesn't matter. I did mark them, one and two, and I marked the board that it interfaces with, so I'll get it right when it matters, but right now, I have no idea. But they had basically the same failures. Nothing was majorly wrong with it. I checked every single part on both boards, and there were three capacitors that were marginal. They were technically okay. But they were just right on the borderline, so I figured let's go ahead and replace it while we have it apart. It's $3 per board, definitely going to be worth it in the long run when it lasts and when you have better sound quality overall. So the last board that we have left, because we have completed all of those, or at least we finished diagnosing all of those, we'll have to order parts. Just to see how this guy comes apart. So it looks like, is that gonna fit? Yes. Looks like it's probably just these four screws. And here. So this one's been an interesting one. I mean, there's, I don't know, so far maybe 20 capacitors that I found that were bad, nothing else. There's a couple cracked solder joints, but by and large it was capacitors, which is kind of what I expected based on their age. They're reaching the end of their usable service life. They dry out, and they just don't behave properly anymore. Although I don't know what happened with that subwoofer board. Something, well, I kind of do. It was heat related. But every single cap on that board was bad. So let's see. There we go. It looks like there's a little bit of baffling in this speaker. Up here's just a, that's just a crossover. So, resistor, inductor, and capacitor just uses resonance to separate the frequencies out to the tweeter and the woofer at the appropriate ranges. So, I can test this capacitor. Non-polarized, and just make sure that one is good as well. But that doesn't really help me, because what I want is down in here. I thought that's what I was getting into. Not sure how to get into that. Pull this baffling out. That's what I was talking about in the subwoofer. There was none in the subwoofer to dampen out resonances, which is a little unusual, but I suppose it's okay. There's that date code again, 81004. So how do you suppose this comes off, actually? Is it just snap. I don't want to break it. I don't see any screws there. Okay. There's got to be something. Huh. That's a big hunk of magnet there, isn't it? Anyway, I'll keep inspecting this thing and figure out how it comes off. I'll get back to you. Alright, I figured it out. So this piece here slides along this rail and has its own piece there, and you just have to push it back and then it pops out. So to put it back in, I'll have to pull it forward. To make this easier, pull these cables out of here. There we go, set that aside. I disconnected the speaker over here just so I don't damage it. So we got four screws here. Of course. Of course. Let's see what I got here. I had the right one somewhere. Ooh. I know where the right one is. It's upstairs. Of course. It's never there when you need it. Don't feel like going to go get it. It's one of those things where you struggle because you don't feel like getting the right tool, but if you would have just went and get the right tool, you could have done it much easier and much faster. But I just don't feel like it. There we go. I don't want to lose these. There's three. There we go. Okay. Pull that off. This needs to go. Well, it's only going to fit one way. So this is the knob. The battery's going to die soon. This is the knob there that has the issues. See, there's a lot more grease or gunk dried up on there than there is on the other one. Only two screws holding it together, though. Let's take a look. I think probably my battery's gonna die before I can do that. There. Oh, come on. There we go. Screws have been in there a long time. So I think, oh, we've got the jacks here on the side. There we go. Sweet. Oh, look at that. So this one's for the subwoofer. This one's for the main. So what they did is they have two independent channels and they just ganged two potentiometers together for each channel. So when you're turning it, you're just turning the two. They look pretty sealed. Hopefully there's a way to get in there and actually clean them. There's like a rivet in the back. I don't like my chances of getting that apart and back together again, but you know, I might be able to just, ugh, it's sticky. I might be able to just spray in there and turn a few times, something like that. We'll see. Alright, we've got a few caps gunked down. We can take a look at those and see if they're any good. It is now several days later, and through the magic of television, I have all of the new parts. Here are the old ones, by the way. There's that potentiometer for the volume knob. A ton of caps that were bad. But no resistors or transistors, anything like that that I found bad, so that's good. But yeah, got all these new parts. Plenty of new parts to install. So I'll go through and solder all those in and we'll give it a test and see if it works. By the way, I've got my air handler, whatever you want to call it, my exhaust system. I can't think of it. I'm tired. Air filter for soldering. Fume extractor. I knew I'd figure it out eventually. So, yeah, I'm going to be doing a lot of soldering. So, best to work smart. Just putting the last of the capacitors in. This is the subwoofer board, the one that was charred. So, yep, make sure I get it in the right way around. If I don't do that, it will release the magic smoke that makes it work. And it's really hard to get it back in, and it smells really bad. So I really don't want that. So it looks like, I think we got that right. Another thing I want to look out for is I don't want this capacitor to touch this resistor here, because I think that's what caused that to overheat. So that we want to avoid. By the way, these are high quality capacitors. All these are Nichicon, United Chemicon, Sprague, Panasonic, good reputable brands, high-end capacitors, and they're all rated to 105 degrees C, whereas the old ones were 85 degrees C. So this will be worlds ahead of where it was before. So I'm just going to solder these in real quick. Hopefully you can see that. Can't tell if it's in the shot. If it's not, you'll probably never see this part of the video. And I'm talking to myself for no reason. Why not? I actually sit here and talk to myself when I'm in the lab by myself anyway, so I might as well just act normal, or as normal as I can be. Okay. Make sure I don't miss any. I also have to repair on this one that pad for the resistor that I cracked. It's actually really hard to do with the camera in the way. I'm sure I'm not soldering this nearly as well as I normally would be. Oh wow, so this one looks a little charred on this one end of the capacitor here. I'll show you in a second. Man, there's some dry solder joints on this connector too, I didn't notice before. Fix that. So, this joint here, I don't know how well you'll be able to see it, but it looks like that pad. Yeah, that pad has ripped off. But you know what I'm going to do? Since I have this extra lead right now, I'm just going to push that down. The other ones are getting in the way right now. And solder it to that. Because otherwise, all I would do is push a wire against it anyway. So it's really the same thing. Alright. Let's see. Did I miss any? There is that pad there that I'm going to have to fix. And that's on that big resistor. But other than that, I think we're good. Got all those caps in there. That one's pushed away so it's not touching the resistor. Polarities look good. So, yeah, just gotta trim the leads. I'm not gonna show this for every single one that I do. That would probably make for a pretty boring video. Get a little solder on this MOSFET here. Some of these have obviously gone dry over time. And by gone dry, I just mean that they cracked. I don't know what a dry... I guess it's more of a cracked solder joint. A dry solder joint is one that doesn't wet the pad properly from the factory. So it's not really a dry joint so much as it's cracked over time, just from stress. I feel the same way. I don't blame it.
Okay.
So the only thing we need to do is we need to bridge from that resistor to here. The other connections look okay, but that one's broken. So I'll just cut a short piece of wire. Actually, I just threw a bunch away in my trash can here. And fortunately, there isn't much in here. I'm digging through the trash.
Ah, hold on, I'll find it.
I think this might be a good example. One of the resistor leads, or capacitor leads rather, after you cut it, tend to make good little jumper links when you need to do repairs like this. So I'll just bend that to approximately where it goes. Hands are shaky. It's just who I am as a person. Okay. Cut that the size. And that, though it may be uninsulated, is my new trace. It's unfortunate it's uninsulated, but in my experience, unless you use a high temperature wire, high temperature insulation on the wire, it'll melt anyway. So it really does not matter. It'll just melt the insulation right off. No point in trying. So we'll tack it in place, make sure it's not touching that other joint. And bridge it across here. I don't know how much you can really see. I'm not zoomed in that close. Sorry. Alright. That should be good enough. Pull that in place. Solder there. Got a little bit hanging off here. I don't want to short out to the pad next to it. There we go. That little bit hanging off will be okay. It's not going anywhere. Okay, cool. So I think push that out of the way so it's away from that cap. Even though it'll be oriented like that and the heat will go up, it'll still radiate down some. That board, other than needing a little bit of heatsink compound, I have to clean the old stuff off. But other than needing a little heatsink compound, this board is done. Set that one aside. I'm not going to show every single board being soldered. I just wanted to show an example. I'll go through the rest and then we'll reassemble this thing. I just wanted to show this really quickly. Here's the new potentiometer on the right. This is the old one, the subwoofer one, over here. I was pretty impressed with myself that I was able to find that 2-gang, exact same value, exact same specs, same D-shaft on it, same length, everything. And it's even the rubber piece that goes on there, or whatever this is, just like that. Try to clean that up though, it's sticky. I don't know why. Anyway, thought that was pretty impressive. Alright, I've got all the capacitors soldered in. Everything's good to go. I'm just gonna use some rubbing alcohol to clean up the old thermal compound off of the transistors. You see it's like caked on there. Kind of boring, I know. But that's what repairing stuff is all about. Being thorough. Okay, see that kind of dirty where it came off on there. So we're just gonna, it's not gonna be perfect by any means, but it should look a lot better. This I think is 39.4, which is just a standard BJT transistor, but I think they're using that to sense the temperature of the heatsink. I think they're using the emitter base diode junction as kind of a crude thermal sensor, which is interesting, instead of actually going with a thermistor or something purpose made for it. So there's one. Same thing over here. So the other channel, this is, I don't know which is which, one is right, one's left. So they're individually sensing the heat sink temperature off of each channel, which again is kind of weird because they're right next to each other. And it's a big thermal mass, that heat sink, so it seems weird that they would need to do that. So we'll clean this off. We'll get some new thermal compound on there that's not completely dried out. That might even be part of the problem here. So, like I said, capacitors, the reason they die is usually thermal related. They dry out as they age, and if they're getting hot, they're going to age much quicker. Although they are, what, 17 years old? Is it? Wow, yes. 2004. It's crazy. So if they're 17 years old, they're already pretty much at the end of their usable life anyway. But heat definitely makes that process happen a lot faster. So if these are not conducting heat away very well into that heat sink, that's interesting how shiny these already were. I didn't have to do much cleaning. It's almost like these weren't really, they either weren't getting hot and dry out the gunk, or they weren't well gunked to begin with. It's interesting. Okay. So those are all cleaned up. I think that's it. I don't think there's any other thermal pads. Oh, well, there's this guy, of course. So I gotta clean all this gunk, this old stuff off here. Probably won't bore you too much with that. Oh, you know, maybe those heat sinks or the, is this the subwoofer one? I don't remember. Is that maybe, can't see that. Is that maybe why? No, there's gunk on that, even. Yeah. There is gunk on that. Did they use, like, thermal adhesive? It's stuck. Oh, there it goes. No, it wasn't thermal adhesive. It was just dry. That might be why the subwoofer is actually different, though, because they used these wafers. I don't know what they are. They feel like almost like some kind of ceramic. I'm not sure. I have not seen these. Normally what people use is silicone pads. So sil pads is what they'll call them. Which actually dissipates heat reasonably well. They're usually impregnated with something that makes them more conductive. It's not just regular silicone. Or mica is really the popular one still, which I think that's a rare earth. I don't know what it is. It's a rock, I guess. So it's pretty rare. That one's clean enough. Got the other one here. I'll show you what mica looks like. It's very thin. If you can see it, it's very thin. Alright, so I got all those parts pretty well cleaned up. You can see that the pads where the heat sinks, or where the transistors go in the heat sink, got all the old thermal compound off. It was pretty crusty. These are pads for where those TO92 transistors went, the 3904s. That they were using to detect the temperature of the heatsink. It's like caulk, and it's still kind of rubbery. And you can actually see, you probably won't be able to see this. I don't know, maybe if you're in 4K, you can see. And there, the text is actually embedded from the face of the transistor. So that's kind of weird. So whatever that stuff was pretty porous at one point. Oh man, I used so much rubbing alcohol, getting everything clean, I can taste it. I got a good buzz going on now. I don't know if that's good or bad. There was like, this had brown stuff, this conformal coating, which is now really hard. I think it used to be rubbery, and it went conductive as well. I had to get that all cleaned off the boards to make sure that wasn't causing an issue. But that was completely covering this area, if you recall. And under that was like a foam pad, which again is just used to, here it's just to keep air from going throughout these holes because it's a sealed enclosure. Well, it's actually a ported enclosure, but you don't want air leaking out of anywhere other than the port that it's supposed to go out of. Otherwise, obviously, you lose your tuning. And beyond that, if you have any little air leaks, it could be audible at some point and actually whistle, and that would be really obnoxious. So, what I'm going to have to do is, once I get everything put together again, and I believe this goes, yeah, like that. So that little connector there, zoom in. Ugh. Terrible camera work here, and I probably won't bother editing it either. This little connector here is going to go down on that, and what I'll do is I'll just, once it's in, put some hot glue around that to make sure we don't get any air leaks behind the board too. So we'll get that back in there, and I'm just gonna go ahead and get everything else put back in. There, so you can see what I'm doing here. That's the crud, hard stuff sealant that I had to chip out of there. On this one, you can see it's still kind of, it used to be clear probably, or maybe like a light yellow, and it's still a little bit rubbery here, so that's how I know that it used to be rubbery. But in other parts, like over here, it's gone dark brown. I mean, you can see from the stuff that I crunched out, it's like almost black, very dark brown, and it just crumbles. So I don't know if that's from heat or age or both, but yeah, it also went conductive, and so it's shorting things out. That probably was not helping the situation with these speakers at all. So, not a good scenario, but we'll get it fixed. So we'll get these spacers back on. We'll put some new thermal compound on there, and we'll get this thing back together. So I started to get some of these boards nestled back together. Here we have the subwoofer board on the power supply board. Had to actually bend some capacitors down, which is a little archaic and medieval, but you know, you gotta do what you gotta do to make it fit. The new capacitors are not necessarily the same size as the old ones. And there is actually an electronic shortage right now, you may or may not have heard of or been aware of in the wake of the pandemic. So it's a little bit hard to get the exact right parts, so we got what we could get. Some of them, I couldn't get the height that I wanted, so I just did the best that I could do. Again, we've got our vent here for safety. Most of the fumes should go in through there. Out of my face. I've been soldering a long time, so I've inhaled a lot of fumes. As such, I figure it's time I stop doing that before I get lung cancer. And some of these are hard to get in. Yeah, these are not plated holes either. It's just a single-sided phenolic board, so whatever solder we can just get on the pad on this side of the board is it. Normally they'd be plated through and it would just flow to the other side of the board, but in this instance it can't. So that's actually a little cocked there, but it'll bend into place. It'll be okay. It's not putting that much strain on the board. Not terribly worried. Just checking the joints. Everything looks pretty good there, so I think that's going to be okay to mount back on. Going to put my heat sinks back on, my thermal compound. This stuff is really old, if you can't tell, but still moist, so I guess it works. I'm kind of getting low though. I've used a lot. Despite only needing a dab. People always overestimate how much of this stuff you need. You know what? I'm going to put extra anyway, because it doesn't hurt. And, I need to buy new stuff anyway. Could use a little more. Actually, I think I did buy new stuff, but I'm going to use the old stuff first. Yeah, it does not take a huge amount. See, it's already squishing out. It does not take a huge amount of thermal compound to do the trick. I mean, these would do pretty well on their own to dissipate the heat, even without the compound, just on the heat sink, but obviously the compound helps quite a bit. All right. So I just got to get that screwed in, but the hard part is going to be remembering where all these screws go. So we've got several with nuts on them, and I do believe these had nuts on the back of them, all of the heat sinks. So there should be six. Yep, there's six with nuts on them, so these will be the right ones. See if I can get that stuck through there. Oh man, this is not gonna be easy. Needle nose. I think that might do the trick. Sorry, I know this is kind of hard to see. But you know what? It's hard for me to see too. Oh, my head's not in the shot. Nobody wants to see that. Oh, shoot. What to do? Oh, it's already out. Check this. Yep, those are no longer aligned. You know, if anything, it helps smear the heatsink compound around a little bit better. Right, that's what I'm going with. So I'm just going to try and preload these tabs with the screws. I'm sticking them through. Instead of trying to drop it down in there and seeing if I can get it lined up that way. I think maybe that looks like it pushed down through. The hard part will now be my desk is a mess now. Bench rather. It's not really a desk. Ah, son of a gun. It already fell out. This thing is heavy. That's very hard to hold by hand. Oh boy. I can see this is going to be difficult to try and assemble. I can already see that. Is that like where all the production cost goes, just trying to assemble the thing? See, I can't even actually have to hold it on there. I don't know if I'm getting this in shot or not. I think I am. I actually have to hold it and try to get these nuts on there at the same time. Because no matter what you do, when you turn it over, there's nothing holding it together. I guess I could have put the other screws in. Alright, I got those nuts on there, so at least it's not going to go anywhere. Let's see. I think it's going to be these screws. I didn't like label them or anything. Probably should have, huh?
That would be the smart thing to do. But you know what? I've got it all on camera. I could always reference it on camera. That fit in there. It's fine. Alright. That pull it in? Yep. Okay. And then, I feel like there's something else. Oh, yes. This move. This guy. The support brace thing. I don't know what you want to call it. I guess it's a support brace. That's what we're going to call it. Make sure it's straight. Yep, that looks pretty good. Pull that in. Pretty good there. Alright. This one. Yeah. I think that's it. Is that tight? Oh no, that one's not tight. There's like red Loctite on there, and I didn't clean it off. I'm starting to think perhaps now that I should have. And I don't want to strip these screws either. Oh, there we go. Yeah, I got it. There's like red Loctite on these, so they don't rattle loose over time, but really, they're not going to. That was just them being overly cautious. And make sure it's in there. Yep. Okay, sweet. It's not touching anything metal, is it? Actually, it is. There's like a jumper link there. I don't know if that's a problem or not. Alright, I moved it. That'll be okay now. Alright. Now, I think the next step will be to assemble the I.O. board and the left and right channels. These nest into each other. Okay, so I've got the mica spacers in place there. I stuck a little heatsink compound down in those little divots where the little 3904 transistors go for, I guess, sensing of the heatsink temperature. And now, I also soldered up this, by the way, and yes, I made sure that the 2 matches the 2 and the 1 matches the 1. It is the way that the boards were oriented before. So now I'm just going to put a little heatsink compound. This time, I think last time I went on the actual, spit it out, what am I saying, spacer insulator. This time I'm going to go directly on the transistors there. Sorry, I keep doing things off camera. I'm not used to doing it on camera. I don't make too many videos anymore. Too many online trolls. They always have comments about how you do things. It's never right. I've been an engineer for 12 years, but I have no idea what I'm doing, so. Okay. If you don't like the way I do it, go get an engineering degree and prove me wrong. Okay. So I think, yeah, these are the ones with the nuts on them. I need to be pushed through again. It's kind of a pain, actually. I don't understand why they actually did that. I guess they didn't want screw heads sticking out of the back of it. They wanted it to be nice and pretty. Which I don't blame them. It was a nicer design, I guess. Nicer look to it. But makes my life more difficult. You know, I think I did this backwards in that. I was talking about how it was supposed to be pretty, and I'm pretty sure I already did some of these backwards. Was it the nuts that were on the inside?
and the screws were on the outside, that makes more sense, but I think I did it, I definitely did it backward. But you know what? It doesn't make any difference. If I get a complaint, I promise I will fix it. But I don't think anyone will care. And this is a whole lot easier to assemble than it would be the other way around. And it's already not easy, as you can see. But you know, you can't even see what I'm doing, but it's fun to watch me struggle, right? I guess? I don't know. Is it? Better than Baby Shark. That's what I do with a lot of my YouTube hours now. So, I'd play some Baby Shark right now if there weren't copyright infringement problems. Although I've learned there's other versions of Baby Shark that people have done. They change the words slightly. I don't know. Maybe that'll be my next video. Baby Shark. We could do some kind of adaptation. Baby Shark Engineering. It's a Baby Shark TV show now. So, I mean, if you can keep kids entertained like that, then I can come up with an engineering one. I'm turning the camera off. This is too hard to do. Wow, that was a chore and a half to get everything in there, but all of the boards are mounted back in and secured. Pretty sure that goes there. Yeah, anyone that knows me reasonably well knew that I couldn't let it stand that the nuts on some of these were on the outside and the screw was on the inside. That was not the way that I received it. That would have bothered me. There's no way I could have left it like that. So I actually put the nuts for the heatsink tabs on the inside on the transistors like they were. That was a lot of work. Whoever installed these, bless them, because they are saints or something, or they have a jig to assemble it, or both. They're saints with an assembly jig, I guess. I don't know. That didn't make a lot of sense, but I'm delirious at this point, so I don't know what I'm talking about. So we need to get these connectors reattached here. A smart engineer would design it such that no two connectors are the same, and you couldn't put the wrong thing in the wrong spot. We'll see how true that ends up being. So that goes, there's one over here, you probably can't see it. That clearly goes there based on how it's zip tied. So that, now we have two. It would seem to me, that probably goes through here. It would seem to me it goes this way. Wow, that's like right at the board. That board there gets in the way of that connector. But I assure you, this is how it actually came out. So I don't know how that was originally in there. That's concerning. Let's see, maybe if I bend it? Yep. That's the trick. Gotta bend it. Wow, that's not nice. That's the way it is, though. Okay. Well, that's clearly based on the length of the cable. So if you can't get it such that you can make every connector different, which they probably could have, but they decided here that instead they're going to wire it in such a way that one physically won't reach to the other. So that's a good call. So I guess the only thing left to do now is to gunk up that hole down in there with some hot glue, and we got to reassemble this guy, this driver here. So I just put everything back together and I was testing it, and it ran for about 20 minutes, and all of a sudden I heard a hiss. I was sitting down in the lab with it, fortunately, and I saw smoke pouring out of the gaps from around a speaker, so that wasn't good. And I found that it's this resistor, at least this is the obvious thing, that got cremated. So not sure exactly what happened. I know that this resistor here, according to the schematic, is between the two power transistors, and it looks like it also was fed by this and this transistor here. It's between these two and these two. So it's possible that one set of these actually shorted out and took that out. I'll have to do some checking and find out. All right, let's check it with the meter here. I think this transistor is our problem. So that should be center pin, yep. 0.1 ohms, 0.1 ohms all the way around. It's completely shorted out. I don't even have to put that on a transistor tester to tell you this one's bad. So what do we have? It's a tip 2C. I'll have to look at what that is. I know it's a tip transistor, but not sure which one, but it's one of the two complementary pairs in the push-pull output. Seems okay here. This driver might also be bad. Oh no, my probes touch each other. Yeah, we're okay there. That's the resistor that I cremated underneath over here. So it's actually this transistor on this side that caused this resistor over here. But that's all dependent on the layout of the board. That has nothing to do with any strangeness going on. It's just that happens to be how they routed it. So it ended up that part was way over here, but it connects to that there. So yeah, I guess I'll go through and do some more checking on the output circuit again. That resistor definitely has to go. This transistor is bad. The other one appears to be okay. So I'll have to order more parts. There's no way I'll have this ready by the weekend like I was hoping, but this is what it is, right? Okay, so I think that other transistor didn't fare so well after all. Here's the one I took out that was shorted, nice and clean. We have a problem. Big black char mark, and one of the pins from the transistor just pulled right out when I desoldered the part. There's that. It has been obliterated. It actually cracked from the heat. So yeah, I think that's our true problem. That one failed. Caused that resistor to draw too much current. Shorted that out, which caused the other transistor to draw too much current, and it shorted out and stopped the cycle. So, or I don't know. It's possible. Actually, I think it's more likely it went the other way. I think this one just shorted out. Yes, that shorted out, drew too much current on that, didn't give a proper bias on this transistor, and caused this one to go into runaway and draw too much current. Yeah, it probably did start with that one. Okay, well, let's see. Is that the entire circuit? Let's take a quick look at the schematic and see. Okay, is this? Can't see it like that. So that transistor that was shorted but was clean is this tip 42C Q10 right there. Now that just goes straight down to the negative rail. So that shorted. So there's a collector to base short. There's also a collector to emitter, but that seems to have survived. This way, we go through R17, 220 ohm resistor, and because that changed the bias on that transistor, it drew too much current, pulled it right through the base, and basically you have a short circuit from positive to negative with these two shorted, and that trying to handle all of the current between positive and negative rail. It clearly couldn't, and it blew, and it actually opened up, which is good because it protected everything else. So that protected this transistor and Q10 and or Q8 there, the drivers for the output transistors. These drivers appear to be okay. I'm going to desolder them and throw them in the transistor tester just to be sure, but definitely I'm going to have to replace these two power transistors and that 8th watt resistor. It's a bummer, but is what it is. We want it to work. We want it to work long term. So we'll do what we need to do. Okay, so real quick, I went ahead and finished retesting this board. I tested all of the parts in this area and decided I'm just going to go ahead and test everything. This capacitor here was a little blackened, and I got a weird measurement with my multimeter, but that was just the other stuff in circuit. Once I took it out, it was fine, and once I cleaned it up, it wasn't blackened anymore. That's just from the smoke from that transistor that failed, so yeah, everything else looks good. It was, this transistor was shorter, this one was blown to hell, and this resistor that's missing there had also went smoke. So I got the bottom cleaned up with a toothbrush and some alcohol, same with the top. Because once it gets that carbon on there, it's actually conductive. It's called carbon tracking. And you don't want carbon. You can already see there's kind of some there between the pins. I might have to scrape that. This is phenolic, not fiberglass. So it's going to do okay, I guess, but I had to scrape that out. It'll be easier to scrape this than it would fiberglass, actually, because fiberglass tends to just crumble. But yeah, I'm going to have to get new transistors and a resistor for that. Not a big deal, just another thing to do. I'm going to go ahead and check the other channel. I don't know if this is the left or the right. Really doesn't matter. They're exactly identical except for reference designators. But I'll check the output transistors and the same parts on the other board just to make sure we don't have a similar incident. And when I actually order these transistors, I think I'm just going to order another set for the other board. They're like 80 cents each. So might as well go in there and do it now while it's easy. All right. I'll give you another update soon. Okay, so this is the other board, and as expected, these output transistors are perfectly fine. Everything else in this area in the output section is fine. That resistor hasn't gone up in smoke yet. Measured the value, perfectly fine. But I'm going to go ahead and replace these two anyway, just to prevent any further issues, since they do have some wear on them now. So I'll have to get everything ordered, and I'll give you an update when I get the parts. It'll be instant for you, but I have to wait. So I got the rest of the unit here. The only thing that's left here is the subwoofer board on the power supply, and I was thinking about it. I might as well order these MOSFETs for this board as well. It's the output driver MOSFETs for the subwoofer board. And interestingly, on the other boards, the other two, it's BJTs and this is MOSFET, but that might be because this is a Class D amplifier and they're not worried about linearity. It's basically a square wave, and then they run it through a giant inductor, and that filters out everything except for, ideally, the fundamental frequency, and all the higher harmonics of a square wave will get filtered out. Lots of theory, Fourier theory, not that interesting. So, anyway, yeah, I'll get these two transistors as well. They're pretty cheap. And once more, through the magic of television, I have all the parts that I need. So I've got the PNP BJT transistors, one of the MOSFETs. I don't know if that's P-channel or N-channel. There's the other one. And then this one is the NPN bipolar junction transistor. I got extras in the MOSFETs just because I think I might use them for myself. But yeah. That should just about do it. The only thing I couldn't get was the resistor, because these boards use 1/8 watt resistors. So I do have a 1/4 watt resistor here. It's the smallest one that I actually have. They don't really make 1/8 watt resistors. I did look on Mouser and DigiKey for 1/8 watt, and I really couldn't find it in any type of percentage tolerance, temperature, coefficient, anything like that. So I'm guessing that the need for smaller resistors like that has been just obviated. There's no need for it anymore. If you need small parts to make a compact design like this, you'd use surface mount parts. You wouldn't use small through-hole parts anymore. So I guess they keep it to the more common 1/4 watt, half watt, 1 watt, 2 watts. And the 1/8 watt and 1/16 watts, they're pretty much useless at this point. So they're just not selling them, not even as repair parts. So we'll use this. We'll make it fit. It will look okay. And it'll work well enough. Alright, there's one channel done. I don't know if it's left or right, but it's one of the high frequency ones, not the subwoofer. So I got that little resistor in there, just kind of sticking up. That's actually not an uncommon design technique from the 80s and 90s for making more compact designs where one end will be standing up. They're a little bit more vertical than that usually, but it's pretty common practice, so that's going to be just fine. That's not going anywhere. And yeah, these transistors that I put in look crooked, but I did screw this board in, and I screwed these down to the heatsink, and this is actually just the way that it lines up. So, yeah, they're a little crooked, but you're not going to be able to tell that when it's actually in there. So, don't know why these line up differently. I know that the packages are slightly different, so the holes are going to be in different spots than they used to be before. Even these two are different from each other, as you can see. They have different tabs on them. So, they're both supposed to be TO220, but they are slightly different. So, anyway, that's one done. I will do the other channel. This is the one that actually failed, where we had the other two bad transistors and the resistor that charred up. So this is the one with the new replacement parts in it that had gone bad. The other one's perfectly fine, but I think I'm going to go ahead and replace those transistors just to be on the safe side. And like I said, I'll replace the MOSFETs on the subwoofer just because we want this to last, you know, hopefully another 15 years or so. Hopefully. So I just got this other module out to go ahead and replace the transistors. This one over here on the left is looking okay, but this one on the right, if you can see the text, see how this one you can read the text pretty clearly? It changes with the angle of the light. That's normal because it's laser etched into the plastic. But in this instance, even with the light right, that text is kind of hard to read. It's almost like it got hot. So I think that got pretty hot. I don't know what's going on with the capacitor there. It looks... is that a shadow or is that just dirt? I think it's fine though. Ceramic capacitors don't really get hot usually. But anyway, yeah, even though this measured good and it was working, I don't like the looks of that, so I'm kind of glad I'm replacing it. Anyway, yeah, these two are coming out next. Okay, it's a couple days later now. This video has probably spanned across a month at this point. But I did get all the new transistors in there for the left and right channels. And I did do the repair down on this board here. You can see that resistor in there. So it's got the new transistors in. I know that one looks a little crooked, but it does actually line up. I installed this first, bolted them down, then tacked these into place on the board so that the holes would line up, and then finished soldering them. So while it may look bad, that's the way that it lined up, and that's actually the way the old ones lined up. So I blame their quality control. I don't know. And yes, I did have these screwed down as well, so that should have been all in place. And then, of course, as I said I would do, I got the subwoofer board. I got the new MOSFETs on there, so those should be good to go. These weren't bad. Neither were two of them on the other channel, but at this point, I decided to just go for it and install all new transistors. Really, the transistors are the only thing that should take anything out at this point, unless one of the capacitors that I had tested before decides to go bad. That's always a possibility. That could end up taking out one of the transistors or resistors, but there's only so much you can do. You know, it would not be economically feasible to replace every single part on the boards, all of the capacitors and everything. That, for the most part, has been done at this point. You know, these are new. Can't remember which of those are new, but let's see, what does it say? I can't read that. Yeah, this one's not new. Oh, maybe it is. That one's definitely new, because that's 105 degree rated. And so, okay, so this one, Suscon. This one is original, but these three are new, and that's the only other electrolytics on the board. So this one electrolytic on each board is the only one that's left, and then the other three for each board is a replacement. And I think, let's see what we got here. Can't really tell what's what. Oh yeah, there's 85 degree C, so that's an old one. 85 degree C, it's an old one. Everything I replaced was with 100 degree C. So these are all original caps on this interface board. But these all tested good, very good. Anything that was just a little bit suspect of those Suscon, any sus capacitors, I replaced. So these are original in the power supply because these tested very good. But those are not the sus ones, these are G Luxem, which I've never heard of either. Well, there's a Suscon. Yeah, but these all tested very good, so I'm not really concerned. These are all new in here because these tested bad. And, of course, all the ones on the subwoofer board are new. So there's been a lot of parts replaced, but at this point, I feel quite a bit more confident that nothing else is going to fail. So I'm going to mount it back onto the panel. I'm not going to record that again. That would be very boring, so I'll go ahead and get that done and we'll try it out again and we'll see if there's any smoke this time. Okay, I got everything back together, everything's plugged in, and I've got some royalty-free music playing on my phone because we don't want YouTube giving us a copyright notice. I decided I'm going to do the power up on video this time, so if we get any smoke or flames or it just goes poof in general, we'll get it on video. Do like a photonic induction channel thing until it pops. Hopefully not. I just put it back together. All right. Here goes. I'm scared. The pop's normal. All right. We have a green light over here. I hear both channels. Sure, this music sucks. There's gonna be a bunch of bass. Let's get the sub going. Oh yeah. There's bass. I don't know if you can hear the bass on this terrible camera microphone. Crank it down a little bit. Baby's actually sleeping right now, and I'm right below him. My lab's right below his room. Yeah, sounds really good. Bass sounds good. Nice and clean. We're getting sound from both speakers. What is this music? It's horrible. Sounds like every pop music station just on repeat. So it ran for a while before it blew up before. I don't really want to keep the camera running. Sounds good. Hopefully it keeps going. So many hot spots. This is also the heat sink on the back. I wouldn't expect any hot spots considering this is at a pretty low level. Did the music just stop, or is that normal? Hold on, I'll fast forward. I think it might just be between songs or something. There we go. It says best non-copyrighted music 2020, 1 hour copyright free music mix. I hope that's right. I hope I don't get dinged for this. Just sounds like normal pop music to me. Hear that sound coming from the speaker here? I don't know if that's the music, or if that's the speaker itself. I think it might just be in the music. It's like some static or something. Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's in the song. Oh, let's try another one. Doesn't matter to me, it all sounds the same. What the heck are we listening to? Yeah, I don't hear anything now, it sounds nice and clean. That bass sounds good. Nice and smooth. Yeah. Nice and cool. It's like room temperature. It hasn't gotten warm at all. Alright, well, I think we might be past the point where there'd be any action. I think I'm just going to let it run for a little while. I'll be playing around down here, and we'll hear if anything happens. Music's been playing for a while now, maybe like 45 minutes to an hour, something like that. I switched the music to something a little more palatable for a while, but I've since, as you can hear, switched back to our techno-funk pop jubilee, and still going strong, so I think we're in good shape. I think I might pop in here every day just for a little bit and make sure that it's still techno-funculating the way it should be, but yeah, maybe this is a win. It's looking pretty good. I don't want to call it yet. Don't want to jinx it, but I think we got this thing working finally. Hopefully this is going to last quite a while. I'm going to call it a day. That was kind of interesting. So when I turn the power switch off, the bass cuts out first because that takes the most power. It drains the capacitors in there pretty quickly. But the bass is actually supplied from a separate set of electrolytic capacitors as the satellite speakers. So those ran for a little bit longer off of their capacitors. It's kind of interesting. But yeah, I think that's it. Might be interesting to retry our Bode plot test that we did in the beginning of the video, but I'm kind of tired of this project at this point. It's been like a month of working on it, and I just don't really feel like doing it at this point. It wasn't all that successful anyway. I didn't feel like we got very good data from it, so I might just leave it at that. Anyway, call it a repair success, although it took a lot, very lot of part replacement to get it to this point. what, 6 transistors, a variable resistor, 20 to 30 capacitors, a carbon film resistor, a lot. We got there eventually. So anyway, hope you like that, and I'll see you sometime later. Bye.